So yeah, I'm Adam Ashenfelter. I hail from Oregon in a little town called Corvallis in the U.S., along with Paul here, who's we're here in Prague just this week, and it was nice to this worked out. And so today I'm gonna I'm right in front of that, aren't I? So today I'm going to talk a little bit first about BigML, just to give context about the rest of this talk. But I don't want to make this a marketing piece, so I'm going to try to keep the BigML, or walking through BigML light. After that, I'm going to kind of talk a bit about what I think the key abilities Clojure gives us. Gonna look at BigML, and then afterwards, if we still have time, I'm going to talk about a couple of our Clojure open source projects. Which I think are kind of useful for anyone who might be munging around with big data or streaming data in Clojure. So first, a little bit about BigML. It was founded in 2011. There were just a few of us at first. I think that first year, we hacked things together with Java and whatever else in our first version, and we pretty much threw it all away. And getting into 2012, we adopted Clojure as our main back-end tool. Partially that was because our chief technical officer was a longtime Lisp and Scheme guy. And I came from the Java world, and so we compromised on Clojure. And over the last few years, I've become a convert. And so at the 30,000-foot level, BigML's architecture is that we've got these back-end services that we build in mostly Clojure with a smattering of Java. Those are an entire web service all on their own. On top of that, we have our kind of user web service layer, and that's mostly Python. And then on top of that, we have our website. It's running Django and JavaScript, but more and more we're pushing ClojureScript into that. And then over here, what uses all of our public APIs are different language bindings. So we try to make it easy for programmers to be able to use our machine learning web service. And so we've got bindings in Python and Node.js and Clojure, of course, although that one actually doesn't get as much use as we'd like. And I thought I would do a quick shout out to some of the Clojure libraries. Any of you are Clojure users, that we found these particularly useful. So like I said, our backend runs, all of our backend services run an internal API, and so we've got HTTP services, and we use Ring and Composure to build those. We use Prismatic Schema, which is really nice to make sure we're not screwing up those messages. It's a nice way to define schemas, you know, with native Clojure data structures. These are nice drivers for MongoDB and RabbitMQ. We use RabbitMQ for our queuing systems. And we use slingshots to try to gracefully handle error catching. And then when we're actually doing, you know, the meat and potatoes computational stuff, we use Core Matrix when we're doing matrix math. And we use Prismatic's hip array when we're dealing with primitive arrays, which is actually what we have to do a lot when you really want something to go pretty fast. And in fact, I would say I use hip array more and more often when doing kind of performance work, but still I still sometimes drop out to Java and then just do Clojure wrappers when I'm dealing with primitive arrays a lot. So that's our dirty secret. Now a little bit about what I think Clojure and ClojureScript gives us that are really nice. Well, actually, I'm already forgetting what I was gonna do with this talk. I'm gonna jump in and show you just a little bit of the website itself. So this is our web service, the dashboard view. And anyone who's done any ML or data mining stuff knows the Iris dataset. That's like the hello world of machine learning. And so I'm gonna come here, and this, what we call a source, is the sort of base level. This is where we're reading up a CSV and we try to parse it and say, okay, did we get it right? And so you can look over it and say, yeah, okay, it looks like we've detected the right fields and the right the right field types. So we can create a data set from that. We get something like this, where we build distributions for each field. We see that, oh, okay, there's 50 instances of iris setosa, iris versicolor, and iris virginica. For anyone who's not used to, you know, the ML 101 here, this is a little data set that's trying to classify species of iris based on, you know, the sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. So we can go ahead and create a model. And because species was the last field, we automatically use that as our objective field, and now we've built a decision tree. Our sort of default machine learning modeling tool is a decision tree. We kind of focused on trees because they're so understandable for regular folk, and that's kind of one of our emphasis as BigML, is kind of democratizing machine learning, trying to make it more approachable to non-experts. And so this is our individual decision tree. You can sort of see that which fields it's using to split. So we see this first split is on petal length. And if petal length is less than 2.45, then we know it's iris setosa. We can see that all 50 instances of iris setosa are true for that. But on the other branch, we see that you know, it could still be either iris versicolor or iris virginica. And so the tree continues doing more splits, this time on petal width, and it continues breaking down these the data until we can get down to more leaf nodes. And so, you know, that's a super quick view of how, you know, we build models from data. We also have other varieties. We can do ensembles, you know, bagging and random decision forests and boosting, and we also do some unsupervised learning, so clustering, specifically a souped-up version of k-means and g-means. We do some anomaly detection using a technique called isolation forests, and we can learn association rules and explore those too. So, so that gives you a quick idea, and a little, like I said, all of this is primarily built on a public API, and the web service itself, or the web UI itself, is using that public API. So, so we're sort of an API first company. Oops. Yeah. So some of the unique things I think that Clojure and ClojureScript buys us, first are it let us do some powerful domain-specific languages. The first thing, if you do much work with data, you always have to transform things. So you need to change fields, you need to you know, edit your data sets. And we wanted to be able to do some of that through the UI, through the API, rather than, you know, force people to do that offline. And so we have a Lisp, Lisp-like DSL that lets us reference fields and say how we want to change them. So in this case, we're if you're used to Clojure, you might, you know, recognize the con statement, and we're checking whether field one, that's a field ID, whether it's the value of a particular instance is higher than its mean. And if it is, we're going to make a new categorical field, and we're going to give that above average as the category. If it's, you know, below, then we're going to do below average, and otherwise call it, whoa, mediocre. I don't know what just happened there. And so these are some examples of little flatline scripts. In fact, I'll do a somewhat more complicated one. I think, yes. So this is a little data set of just the weather over a month in April in Seattle. We have things like a categorical field, whether it's overcast or sunny or, you know, other sort of just general weather, how much precipitation there's been recent during this hour. It's an hourly report, the wind speed, yada, yada, yada. So I will create a data set from that. In a second, we should see that. And so now we've, a data set is sort of our serialized and ready to do machine learning version of the data. And it's from this view, where if I wanted, I can add and change fields. So here I can decide to make a new field, and we've got all these different operations here. I can discretize a field if I want to. I can replace missing values with certain other values. I can normalize fields. I can do some math functions. And really, if I use any of these, it's actually just converting that into our flatline DSL. So basically, then a user is using flatline and doesn't know it. But if you want to, you know, for kind of power users, you can go ahead and actually decide to jump into a flatline editor and write flatline straight up. So in this case, let's say we've got the stat, it's really just a time series, but let's say we want to try to do some silly predictions with it. And first we'd like to do, let's say, a window of the past. Say, okay, over the past 6 hours, has it been raining recently? And so we have a, I think it's average window, if I recall right. And here we see of the different fields. I can choose precipitation, and because I know these are, the data comes in hour-long blocks. If I do this, I should get the last 6 hours. And now this is sort of the nice thing right now is I can do validate and see that yes, I didn't screw that up. I wrote that right. And now I can actually get a preview. And I can see, yeah, I just added this last column onto my data, and I can see the precipitation there. And that is actually running in the browser. So that's ClojureScript running this flatline DSL. And it's because flatline itself is built so it can be compiled out to either ClojureScript or Clojure. And that means, yeah, we can get this nice preview in the browser, decide we like it, and let's actually add another one. How about the pre-rain field? Let's add the will rain field. And actually, I'll jump back here again. This time, oops, so it's tricky to type for me. This time we're going to define a forward-looking window. So we're going to say, in the future, in the next 3 hours, will we actually have any rain occur? And we'll go, no. Thank you. Yes. There's also a JSON format, which you can use if you don't like yourself. Do that. Validate. We can look at the preview. And that's not what I wanted. I wanted a Boolean. So we're going to say I want that average to be greater than 0. And now we see falses, 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 and some trues. So we do have times when it's going to rain in the next 3 hours. So we'll go ahead and do that. I'll create this extended data set. Now we go down to the bottom and we see, okay, yeah, we do have times when there was some rain in the past, and we now have some data where, you know, it mostly wasn't raining in the future, but sometimes it did. So now we can go, and because will rain is the last field, and I don't need to change anything, we can do all sorts of model configuration stuff and change the objective field, but if it's the last field, we don't need to. We can just go ahead and do it. And then, in a second, there we go. And we end up with the tree. And now we're predicting, you know, whether it will or won't rain in the future. In fact, I'm going to switch to my favorite view of the tree here. This is the sunburst view, where instead of looking at the tree sideways, you can imagine we've tilted it, and we're looking at the root as the center and the leaves going outward. And it's and we're coloring the nodes now by what their majority class was. So. And the root, mostly, you know, overall, it wasn't going to rain. But we can see once we do the split on if precipitation, current precipitation is less than 0.01, so it's raining a little bit already, then yeah, we think it's going to continue to rain in the future, is what that's saying. No big surprise. If it isn't raining much, but our weather service categorized the world as light rain, well, then we still think it's probably going to rain. And we can see our other branch down here where it looks like, okay, it's not raining much right now. But it's overcast and it has been raining. We just used our previous rain feature. It has been raining in the past 6 hours, so we think, yeah, it's probably going to rain again. So there's a quick example of this DSL doing some feature engineering and, you know, how we're able to validate it on the browser before sending it along to our server to actually re-engineer the entire data set. It's going to keep popping me out every time, isn't it? Okay. So the other DSL we have, and this is one that's flatline we've had for a year or two, something like that. But we liked making DSL so much, we did another. And so we realized we needed a nicer way to orchestrate workflows for machine learning, right? We have all these bindings, and if you like, you can, you know, go get the Python binding or Clojure binding and sort of make a workflow of which models you want to do, how to change your data sets, yada, 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 and do that through the bindings. But there's some drawbacks for that, you know, if you're running some code through the bindings and you close your laptop, you might break the whole, you know, the whole system. Or if, you know, you wrote some code in the Python binding and then the boss says, you know, now you need to have it in Node.js when you have to rewrite everything. But if we have a DSL that's actually another resource in our system, you know, we can get away from that. We can have our own kind of workflow language. So, I've actually stole this example from Paul's recent talk. I'm probably not going to get it as well as he is. I'm pretty new to WSML myself, but the idea here is we're actually grabbing some data from a real estate website called Redfin. I don't know if you've ever seen this site. I have no idea if they do anything in the Czech Republic, but you can, you know, look for houses that are for sale or houses that sold recently, and they have a nice little thing where at the bottom you can actually download it all as a flat file. So I've already grabbed a couple data sets. Oh wait, nope, this is the wrong one. Looking at our production site, I have to go look at our pre-production site because WSML isn't actually public yet. So, okay, I already grabbed some CSVs from Redfin, one of sold homes in the Corvallis area, and one for, you know, things that sold in the last few months, and one for for sale homes. Now, the idea in our mind is we're going to get rich now by learning a model on can we predict the price of a house based on, you know, the sales price of a house based on its square footage. Create this data set while I'm talking. Oh well, we'll look at the data source anyway. So we've got things like its square footage, the number of beds, the bath, when it was built, you know, all this good stuff. And so if we can learn a model to predict the price on that, then we could actually look at the currently for sale data set and make predictions on all of them that are currently for sale and now look for the difference, you know. If we think this will sell for 300K, but the person's asking price is 200, well, there's a deal. Now we can, you know, buy up that house, flip it, and become rich. So that's how we'll be able to close out BigML and become real estate moguls. And now I'm going to, because this could be a hour-long presentation on WSML, and I don't want to do that. So if I really wanted to do this, there are a lot of fields here that I'm not actually interested in that aren't going to help. Like the city's always Corvallis, you know, and I'm only looking at houses, so we've got fields here that are never going to change. And so there's a lot of stuff I don't care about. And in the dataset view, I can go and, you know, or data source view, I can go and I can decide to, that's changing. That's not what I meant to do. Oops. Anyway, all that, click the right button. I can deselect things when I'm deciding what to build for a data set. but I've got two different data sources that I want to do this with. It would be kind of a pain in the butt to deselect all these things and then go ahead and deselect all the same ones from the other data set. And so instead, we can actually, let me jump back. Because Paul had been running this earlier, he already made a WSML script to do it. In fact, we can go look at this WSML script. And again, it's kind of a Clojure-esque again. You might recognize some of the form. where now we just specify which fields we're interested in. And remember, we've got this for sale data set and a already sold data set, and we're interested in different fields depending on which one they are. And so we'll list those, and now we can actually, with this Redfin data set, this is the little function we define up here, where we're taking what the source, the key for the data set is, and the set of fields we want to filter, so the ones we care about. So anyway, we'll build the for sale and the sold data sets the way we want. Then we can go ahead and set up a modeling job on the sold houses data set, setting the objective as the sale price. Then we set up something called a batch prediction, which is a, take our for sale data set and add a field to it, which is our prediction based on that model we just built. And so we do that, and we can set the prediction field we've called a predicted price, so we'll go ahead and do that. And then finally, we'll take that resulting data set, and we will do one of these data set transformations that I just showed off. And we have a function now we called column A minus column B, which is really saying, okay, do this flatline transformation of taking the asking price, and we're going to subtract the predicted price. So there we go. Now we've got an entire script for doing that. We can actually go ahead and if I remember what the, this is new enough that I have not actually done much WSML, so we're going to see if I can remember how to do it. Where's the scripts? Oh, it's up here. It's up here, right. Okay, so I can say I want to import a script. Paul was nice enough to make this so it's shareable. I'll load it up. It says, here we go. Can run the script for me that already knows, because it was well defined, that it should take two different sources as input, a sold source and a for sale source. So now I can the output should be a new data set, and we're going to call this Redfin Deals. So that all looks good. We'll import it, and now I've got this little screen of, okay, well, now let's choose the data sources we want to do this process with. So here I will pick the sold homes and the for sale homes. And now I can execute this this workflow. And again, I guess I should mention that the way I was able to know what the sources were and the outputs were was that we were also parsing the WSML script on the browser side. So again, because it's Clojure/ClojureScript, we can both validate and parse and even have an interpreter written for the browser side before we send those commands to the server to run the same thing. And so here we go. We've got our output deals data set. And, we can see that, apparently we've got some huge deals. We can get rich on these ones. And then if we want, we can, download this as a CSV and get the address and go get rich. But we'll skip that part for later. So that's kind of nice, but there is the, it's not like Lisp has the biggest adoption in the world. And so we invented yet another DSL Lisp thing. How many people are really gonna jump in and use this? Hopefully, we think some, but one of the nice things we're gonna be able to do with it is that whenever we create a resource in our system, like that we run flatline and make a transformed data set, or we build a model based on certain fields, we always keep track of what led us there. So we already have sort of the graph of what happened. And so really, if we can take that graph, we can build a WSML script with it. So we're working on having a reify option where now that you've, you know, worked through the UI and did everything you want, you can go ahead, say, boom, turn this into a WSML script for me. So now that you've got the system, you can now download real estate data for Prague and get rich here too. And you don't have to redo any of the UI. So that'll let people kind of write WSML again without knowing that they're writing WSML. And then we've also started working on our own meta algorithms just in WSML since we can. There's a algorithm called SMAC, sequential model algorithm configuration, I believe. Yeah, which is sort of this Bayesian optimization approach to picking your parameters intelligently. And because WSML is expressible enough, we can actually write that entire meta algorithm in WSML itself, and then you can, you know, fit parameters for any of our models using that. So those, you know, the ClojureScript DSL has been pretty powerful for us. Another thing that's been nice is on the visualization side. So you do mostly visualizations with D3 and JavaScript, but I'm going to show off a partial dependence plot. Explain that. Let's pull up. I don't think I need this one anymore. Yeah, so this is a data set which takes a lot of information about forests. And then the idea is to try to predict what sort of tree is likely to grow in this geographic area. And so we've got, you know, information like what's the elevation, what's the tree's distance to water, you know, how shady is it, all sorts of stuff like that. I already have a model built on it. And for an individual model, it's nice. We can still do things like come over and, you know, look at this pretty view and start seeing that, okay, this ponderosa pine species tends to be at low elevation, it looks like, you know, under 2,500 feet. Whereas, let's say, crumb holes, whichever species that is, tends to be at over 3,300 feet and not in this particular wilderness area. So, okay, we can kind of understand what the tree is telling us, but if you really want good predictive power, single trees are never very good. And so a nice way to kind of level up trees are to use ensembles, so things like random decision forests or boosting or even bagging. And so now we grow lots of trees, and you know, in the case of bagging or random decision forests, we all let them vote. And turns out that can make for pretty powerful predictions, but then you lose this interpretability. You know, it's harder to understand what they're saying or what they're capturing about the data set. But trees do have this, trees do have this, I'm going to do a little aside, so trees do have this nice feature that they can kind of gracefully handle missing data at prediction time. So first, have this tiny made-up data set where all we have are salary and ages inputs, and we're trying to predict, I don't know, whether they're interested in a car. And so we have yes or no as our output classes. And so generally for a tree, we just step down, find the terminal node, which in this case is that salary is less than 50K node. And we see that, okay, we have more yeses than nos, just barely. So that means we'd predict yes. But what if age is missing? What can we do? So in this case, we can actually just treat either side of that, they're all kind of the same color on this projection, isn't it? But anyway, we treat both of these as potentially true. And so we end up with two terminal nodes now, both this one and this one. And we can sum together their distributions and come up with an overall distribution from the terminal nodes and decide no. And with that idea, actually, we can sort of marginalize out fields. So we can make a plot now, these partial dependency plots, This is looking at that same forest cover data set where I can choose, in this case, distance to road and elevation as my x and y axes, and treat all the other fields as no. So I'm just going to say, you know, pretend we don't, you know, pretend they're missing, and just treat them like, you know, take both branches whenever you run into one of those splits. And this way we can see how the our ensemble output changes based on the distance of road changing and elevation changing. So that's what these partial dependency plots show. And then we can, you know, do nice things. We can zoom in and kind of look at the decision boundary. Over here we think it's spruce fir. Over here we think it's lodgepole pine. In this dark area, we start to have conflicts between our trees, like only some of them are voting lodgepole pine, 64.5% it says. I think there were like 30 trees in this ensemble. But so anyway, you kind of get you can kind of see what the ensemble is capturing about the problem space. But the trick is we have, you know, so many trees, 30 trees, something like that. We have, I think, 32 by 32 cells in this plot, and we're actually evaluating all the trees for every cell. And that can get kind of expensive, especially if you had a bigger set of trees. Maybe it's 1,000 trees, you know. And yeah, so sort of showing here, we've got grid rows by grid columns, and can I just close this? Nope. Spend the 10 seconds to do this yet again. Okay. So yeah, we sort of grid rows by grid columns times the number of trees or how many evaluations we're doing. But even worse, we have to combine those distributions at all the terminal nodes, right? And so how many terminal nodes are we going to have in each tree times each grid column times each grid row? It can get kind of expensive, and we don't like that. But there's a trick. We can say, you know what, if in this case we know which x and y axis we care about, we know we don't care about all the other ones, so we can do things like, in this case, since we're treating age as missing, well, we're always going to count this distribution as part of the answer. So we can just ahead of time work it into these two terminal nodes. And we don't need this node at all, it makes no difference, so we can kill that one, and we've now reduced our tree. Now it only depends on salary, and this is the answer we would have gotten otherwise. So we can take each tree and kind of boil away, you know, hopefully a large majority of it down to the part we care about, which then makes these evaluations go way, way faster. And so we have a library which will in fact take trees, reduce them, given the dimensions you care about. Then we actually turn the trees from a nested structure, which we have at first, into kind of this array storage version, which lets us query them a little faster. And then we go ahead and we evaluate them all. But the nice thing now is we wrote it in Clojure and ClojureScript, so we can do it either on the browser or we can do it on the server. So if you have a smaller set of ensembles, we can just send all those trees to the browser, and now it's pretty quick, pretty interactive. Like I won't switch over because that'll take an hour. But you know, like you saw when I zoomed in, it happened right away. But if you have 1,000 trees or 2,000 trees because you were feeling lucky, you know, we don't want to send that gigantic JSON message to the client. So instead, we can now just do the exact same work on the server side and just send the resulting colors for all the cells. And it's not quite as snappy, but, you know, it scales much better than sending all the JSON. And so one of the next things we're adding are some heat maps. We already had some scatter plots, but we figured heat maps were basic enough that they were good to do, especially since some people are bound to be kind of confused between partial dependency plots and heat maps. Because partial dependency plots are only capturing kind of what your model thinks about these two fields rather than how the data is, you know, actually fluctuates according to these columns. So we wanted a heat map to balance that out. And so this is actually looking at the same road distance and elevation, but more like a traditional heat map. I don't know how clearly that comes through. It's okay. I can choose to color it by forest type. And because this is a demo, my colors here do not match the colors in the partial dependency plot. But you see this is the spruce fir area, this is the lodgepole pine area. I'm coloring them by the most common class. And so you can see this, you know, these two fields separate it decently well. But I can also zoom in anywhere I feel like. And you notice the our heat map is automatically kind of choosing different number of bins. And so we try to intelligently choose the bins so it just, you know, looks okay no matter what where you're zooming into. You can override if you want and get, you know, views like that, but intelligent bins help make it just more easy to jump into. But once again, we're doing the trick where if you have, but the library to do that, bin resizing is Clojure and ClojureScript. So we can do it either in the browser side or on the server side. And so if you've got a really big data set, we don't want to send that to the client. You know, that's kind of stupid. So we'll generate this heat map and choose the bin size and do all that on the server. But if you've got a smaller data set, well, yeah, we'll send that to the client, and now you've got a really snappy interactive heat map. So that's sort of what it buys us there.
But do you really need the whole data set for this animation? Well,
versus a sample?
Because you just need the tree. You just like put the values of the features there and you get the whole picture.
Well, no. So this one really is just a heat map. We're not looking at anything to do with the model. This is just looking at a data set.
Oh.
So it was that partial dependency plot, which you're right. The partial dependency plot, you only need the trees. But we also wanted a, you know, a more traditional heat map view. All right, so that's a bit about what we, you know, I think the interesting things that Clojure and ClojureScript buy us. So now I think we still got a bit of time, so we'll go and talk some about our open source Clojure libraries. One more time. So, first I'll just mention we have three of them that I think are pretty useful, and they're all kind of useful in the world of dealing with large amounts of data or streaming data. One is sampling with different sampling techniques. And one is something called a streaming histogram, and then another is kind of a collection of different sketching algorithms, hashing and sketching algorithms that will give you probabilistic summaries of the data set. So first, the sampling one, which I kind of think is perhaps the most useful, has kind of three different flavors of sampling, depending on whether you can keep the data in memory or whether you can keep the resulting sample in memory. So simple sampling, or what I called simple sampling, is just, okay, we can keep our original population in memory, that's fine. And the resulting sample we can produce as a stream. And we have something called reservoir sampling, which works well if you can't keep your data in memory, but you do need to keep the resulting sample in memory, so you need to be able to do that. And then finally, there's one called stream sampling, where you stream on both sides. And so I'm going to just kind of throw up Clojure code, and we'll work through some of it here. And this is just showing the namespace I'm setting up to use simple reservoir and stream sampling. And so the general thing with simple sampling is you just give it a collection of items, and we're going to sample from those. And you can take however many you want. By default, we sample without replacement. So since I only had five items, we return five items, basically just shuffled. So, and because it's nicer to just not have to type everything out, I'm most of the time going to just use a range of numbers as our items. But the items can be anything. They can be maps. They can be whatever object you like. so we could say replace is true, and now we do sample. Now we're doing sampling with replacement. That is more like, okay, if you're rolling a die and three comes up, well, if you roll it again, three might happen again. You never lose a possible value. And that means you can roll your die and generate random numbers forever. And similarly, this function will generate samples forever, and so you just take as many as you want. And this is showing that each time you call it, we'll use a different random seed for our sample. So you'll get a different ordering or a different sample each time you call this function, unless you give it a seed. And so if you add a seed, and the seed can be anything that's hashable by Clojure, and then you'll get a repeatable output. And there's also an option to change your random number generator. So if you're actually doing things like simulations where you care about the quality of your random numbers, the default generator, which is a linear, I can never say that, the LCG generator, is not terribly good. There's structure, a little bit of structure when you're sampling from it. So the other option is to use the Mersenne twister, which is slower but gives better quality results if you're doing simulations. And the other thing we can do is we can define a weighting function on our samples. So in this case, we're defining just two items, heads and tails, and now we're going to define a weighting function, and because if you have a map in Clojure, you can use a map like a function. So we're just going to define this map where we say heads is 0.5 and tails is 0.5, and then we're going to do a replacement true, and there you go. Now we're going to flip coins forever, take as many as we want. We'll have a 50-50 chance. But maybe we want to cheat when we're flipping our coins. So in this case, we're giving heads a weight of 2 and tails a weight of 1. They don't have to sum to 1. As long as they're non-negative and not all 0, we won't complain. And then we'll flip 100 of those, and sure enough, we get about twice as many heads as we do tails. So that's sort of that was simple sampling. Then there is reservoir sampling, and maybe many of you know of reservoir sampling, but if you don't, here's kind of what it does. So we want to be able to sample over a bunch of data too big to keep in memory. And let's pretend we have our super crappy computer, so we can't even keep these 7 items in memory. But we can keep 3. So this is our reservoir. We've got 3 spots for 3 items, and we want to basically take 3 of these. So we'll start with A, I'm getting ahead of myself. Just imagine we have a random number for each one of these, and we're actually going to generate this random number for each item we see. So it's not like they come with them ahead of time, but as we get one, we'll flip a coin, roll a die, whatever, get a random number. And these are the ones we'll see. And we'll start off, we'll select A, because we've got nothing in our reservoir yet, and we'll select B, we just want to fill it up, and C. And so we get here, and now we've got item D, and it's got a 0.7. And we want to keep the highest numbers, so we're always going to kick out the lowest. So we're going to kick out C now, and put D in our reservoir instead. And E is 3, it doesn't actually beat out any of these, so we don't include it in our reservoir. F does beat out B, so there we go, and G doesn't get any either. And now that we've done that, we've got our 3 randomly sampled items from that reservoir. So hooray! We can also extend that. So what if we want to give weights to these items? Well, we can do that too. So now we've got, again, these random numbers, but we also have, this time they're coming in with, there's a weight function that someone gave us, right? So if we have a weight function, some way to generate these, now how do we pick the top 3? Well, it's as easy as we just multiply the random number against the weight, and now we pick the highest that falls out from that. I'll skip doing the bit-by-bit animation. You see we picked D, C, and F, which had the highest combination of random numbers and weights. So that works pretty well, but as it turns out, if you've got a ton of data, generating a random number for every item is actually kind of computationally expensive. And so if we're clever, we don't have to do that. And to get around it, we will just say, okay, let's forget about those random numbers. We don't want to generate them every time. But we have to keep track of a couple of other values now in our reservoir. And value over here on the left will be the sum of all the weights we've seen so far. And if we were dealing with unweighted data, these would all be ones, but we're gonna we use weight values instead. And so we're going to fill up a reservoir, and we're keeping track of the sum of the weights. So, and at this point, we've got 1.2 is the sum of our weights so far. But now we've filled up our reservoir. So now what we do is we use the sum of the weights and the number of items that have we've seen go past. And we can actually use that to compute a threshold for the future. And we just say, you know what? We're going to skip the rest of the items until the sum of the weights I've seen exceeds this threshold. And when it does, then I'll sample whichever item that happens to be. And so, you know, we run the numbers and we come up with 1.7 as our threshold. And this item D here, well, that's 0.9. If we sum that, that already beats our threshold, so we sample it. And I should say, we do generate a random number when we're filling in this cell here. So that is one random number we generated. We ended up taking D because it exceeded the threshold. So now we have to generate a second random number and set a new threshold, this time at 2.9. And when we sum E with 2.1, it's under the threshold, so we don't take it. We just leave it out. Same thing with F. We don't exceed the 2.9 threshold, so we leave it. But G, finally, we exceed the threshold, and so we'll take it, and there's our random sample. But now we only generated two random numbers rather than seven of them. So, and if you have a lot of data, it tends to, you know, you just generate only a handful of random numbers compared to the overall amount of data. So that speeds things up a whole lot. So anyway, that's kind of what's going on behind the scenes with our reservoir sampling. And the way it's implemented in the library is we used a def type. So if you're in Clojure land and you actually want to build like a data structure that works with conj, which works with into some of the standard Clojure functions, just like a vector would or just like a list would, then you want to, you know, you probably want to use def type. So we did that, and that means we can do this reservoir create, and we tell it, you know, three elements. That's what we care about. And now we can just do a reduce and say put things into it. And we give it 10 items, and these are the three that fall out. Similarly, instead of reduce conj, we can use into and get the same, you know, same sort of thing. And then for convenience, we can also just say reservoir sample, and you give it a collection and a size, and it will give you the reservoir at the end. And if we want to see it in action as we keep adding elements in it, this is basically a version of the little boxes diagram that I just did. We're doing reduction, so we can see as we add in elements, it's our reservoir starts with nothing, then we have 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 2, and you know, we iterate through sometimes adding elements, sometimes not. And this is our final reservoir, so we can kind of see how it works. Now, one of the nice things about these reservoirs is that they're also mergeable. And this is kind of a big deal if you're actually running in a distributed world. Like, you've got lots of...
I can't imagine where would you use this in the real world. Like, why would you use reservoir?
Well, so let's say you're running a bunch of servers and you're keeping track of metrics. So, like, people are coming and, you know, you want to see what the latency is. But you just want a small kind of capture the distribution in a small way that you can now, you know, send to some other server to plot it, and we can see what our latency looks like. And so to keep those messages small, we can still do a reservoir of maybe 10,000 points, and that's small enough to send, and, you know, we don't worry about the other 100,000. We think the 10,000 is representative. So that's sort of a way to capture streaming data. And in that same...
Just wondering if it is a bit like heavy for the garbage collector? Everything's immutable and you're basically substituting values?
Well, with the def type, where it's a little bit better than that.
It's like here.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's the mutations hidden within the def type. So... But if you were just using like a Clojure vector rather than, because the def type kind of let us build our own data structure. But if you're using just a Clojure vector, then yeah, it would be a little more costly. But I would say also with, since we're doing this skip operation, you don't actually do that many edits, right? If you have a million points and you're doing a reservoir sample of of 1,000, you're not actually inserting them all that frequently, and so it doesn't really matter too much.
Can I one more question, just to complete the example you gave us? So suppose we use it for some server statistics.
Mm-hmm.
What would be the number which is telling if you should take it or not?
Oh, you mean like when
the threshold. So you decide based on some number if you put a sample in a reservoir or not.
Mm-hmm.
So what would be the number in case of servers?
So, I mean, if you cared about certain things, you could give it some sort of weighting function, but without it, like, every instance has the same weight.
Okay.
Has the same, overall, everything has the same probability of getting sampled. So, you know, if you took 100 from a million, you have, you know, 100 over a million chance for each point being part of it. And the other thing is they can be merged. So if we are running in this, you know, server metrics in the world where you had like 10 servers running, well, you can actually take the reservoirs from all 10 and recombine them somewhere, even if you've had different numbers of points from, you know, one server saw a million points, the other saw 10 million, you can recombine them in the right way. So this is just sort of showing that off by doing a range over 10,000 points and adding them all up. And now we're kind of breaking that into 0 through 5,000, 5,000 through 8,000, 8,000 through 10,000, and we get, you know, a similar number, which is what we'd expect, just sort of showing that we're recombining different sized reservoirs that have seen different numbers of points, but they're still getting uniform distributions. And then under the hood, there are actually two different implementations. The one that is you want to use most of the time, the one that does the skipping that we mentioned, is actually costly if you do sampling with replacement, which is sort of a weird thing to do for reservoir sampling anyway. But if you wanted to do sampling with replacement and reservoir sampling, there's another implementation that makes that faster. So that's the reservoir sampling. And the other is stream sampling, where you can give it a, you know, infinite sequence, and it'll generate a streaming sample coming out of that. But you do have to tell it how many points you expect to see in your sequence. So that is kind of the cheat, you know. You don't have to keep in memory, but we do need to know how many we're going to see. So in this case, we say, I want to sample 5 things out of the first 10 things we see. And then we'll get a stream of that. Now, the other thing with streaming samples is that the items will stay kind of in order. We'll sample correctly, you know, over that, but they won't be randomized. So if you need them shuffled, you'd have to shuffle them on your own afterwards. Replacement, and you can do seeds. But you can't do weights with stream sampling, so that one doesn't work. Another thing you can do, though, that it does allow is out-of-bag samples. So in this case, we're sampling 7, you know, give me 7 out of the first 10 items I see, we get this. But if we use the same seed and say out-of-bag true, we'll get the complement, basically. So now we've got the complement of the set. And this is showing off that there's also a rate parameter. And so you can imagine, without the rate parameter, we're saying, okay, give me the one item out of the first 1,000 I see. And so in this case, we get 229. Right? But if we run it with rate equal true, our samples are no longer conditioned on the previous results. So we're just saying every item I see, I'm just going to take it at a rate of, you know, I might sample it at the rate of 1 out of 1,000. And in that case, we didn't even get a sample in the first 1,000, but we did end up with one at 1,149, right? Because now we're just, it no longer, in the first case, we were doing kind of, if we didn't take samples in the first 999 chances, we're, you know, absolutely going to sample the 1,000th, because that's what we ask for, is give me one out of the first 1,000. But in this case, we're ignorant, and we're just, you know, flipping a 1 over 1,000 coin each time and taking what falls out. And when you do that, that also means it'll produce samples forever. It won't ever stop. So then you take however many you want.
Question?
Mm-hmm.
So then yeah. You could possibly just not track the number of you can use some rate that's slightly higher than that would correspond to a slightly higher number of samples that you want to actually achieve, and then just throw them away.
Yeah, first then you'd have to subsample if you want it perfect. Yeah, I think the next one is kind of
two pass.
Yeah, two pass. You'd have to do a second sample afterwards, but if you have a smaller set, that might work. But yeah, kind of to that point, if you don't care about being exact, so in this case we're saying, you know, take roughly half the points from 10,000 points, right? And in the first case, we're doing it exactly, and we see it takes, you know, about 380 milliseconds. But in the second case, we don't care. We're just doing that ratio, and like you said, it's clear it's going to be a much, much faster because we're just one random number for each. Yep. But you don't get exactly the points that you ask for. As long as you're cool with that, yeah, whatever.
But if you took, say, 5,500, that would take approximately the same time, let's say 40 milliseconds, or I don't know. And then you could just select, you wouldn't use the same algorithm. You would just select the indices that are to be removed. And that's a very small set. It would be like, I don't know.
Yeah, although you would have to keep track of how many you've sampled, right? And and then you'd have to do, and if you're going to do a second pass, you might have them in memory, so then it's probably you should have just used reservoir sampling, right? Because, yeah.
In order to remove them, you have to actually go through all of them. Even if you remove one in the middle, then you have to shift all of the others in order to get it continuous in the memory, so yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But maybe if you, you know, wrote it to disk or something and then we're reading it off. But
stuff are always fast. I mean, it's incredibly fast, much faster than.
Yeah. But so there might be something. But,
it's probably quite difficult to keep track the real probability of. It's not that easy to do it right. So if you do this magic trick, the probabilities could be like skewed.
Well, if you keep track of how many you had, so, okay, we ended up with 6,000, and now we're on our second pass, we know we really wanted 5,000. We can, you know, now run it again with, well, I don't know, reservoir sampling or with the exact one, but on a smaller set, and maybe that's faster. But yeah, yeah. More work, but maybe faster, I don't know. Even though we can't wait, we can, I did add in a thing called cond sample, where in this case I'm, you know, pulling up the iris data set again. So just to show, if we look at the last, you know, it's just a bunch of different rows as vectors. If we look at the last value and take the frequencies of those, we see we have 50 iris setosa, 50 versicolor, 50 virginica, like we expect. and so if we'd like, we can define a sample saying, okay, here's a function, and the function evaluates to true if the item is iris setosa, and then we give it the how many we expect and how many we want. So in this case, we say give me all of them. For versicolor, we say give me 25 out of 50, and for virginica, we say, you know, drop them all, I don't care. And then that's the sort of eventual sample we get. And so if you've never done stratified sampling, that's more or less what you want to do. We can do that in a streaming setting. So that's the sampling library. And I don't know, how much time do we have left? Okay, well, Another. Okay, well, I'll go over the streaming histograms then. But if we're getting too antsy, it doesn't hurt my feelings to cut it, get it short. So we mentioned using these reservoir samples to collect a bunch of items that then you, with those items, then you could build a histogram and understand a distribution of something, right? So that's one of the uses for them. But there is a case where, let's say whatever stream you're sampling from, maybe the item zero happens a lot, right? Maybe it happens 99% of the time or 99.99% of the time. Well, now if you're taking a reservoir sample, almost all your samples are zeros. And then you get a few samples that are non-zeros. And you know, maybe it's that rest of that distribution you cared about, but this, you know, this crappy number got in there. And so now you've kind of lost resolution on the rest of the distribution that you cared about. And that is one example of where now a streaming histogram can be useful. So, oh, that went crazy. So a streaming histogram, I won't go into the algorithm too much, but we can see it at work. The idea is more or less that we have so many, you define so many bins, so much memory that you want to use. But we don't know exactly where the centers of the bins will be. And as points come in, we can actually move the center of our bin, you know, left or right. And so we can adapt. The downside is it's approximate. We never know that there were really, you know, 200 points in this bin. Maybe there was actually only 195. Maybe there was really 205. So it's an approximation of the true distribution, but in practice it gets pretty close. So this is a example of a wine quality data set, one of these UC University of California Irvine data sets. And so I'm looking at, we're going to watch the streaming histogram in action. The y-axis is just, you know, how many data points we've seen, and you can sort of see it at the beginning doesn't know what the distribution is going to look like, but kind of fits it over time. And there's actually two ways you can do a linear interpolation, which gives us these kind of flat spaces on the bins, but you can also do a trapezoidal interpolation, which tries to make it smoother, but only somewhat. Another nice thing about them is that they can actually work even if your data is ordered. And so this is where you could get into trouble if, let's say you had a streaming data coming in and you're like, you know what, I'm just going to put into memory the first 10,000 points because that's no big deal. And from those 10,000 points, then I'll choose the correct bin sizes for my real histogram. And now for the rest of them, I'll just, you know, drop it in the appropriate bin. Well, if your data is actually ordered in some way, that works terribly, you know. Then you've got bins all over on one side of the distribution and everything falls into the, you know, the one on the end. Well, so now I'm kind of replicating that. In this case, I've now sorted my wine alcohol percent and I'm dropping it into the histogram in sorted order. And you can sort of see it uses, I'll stop real quick, and you can sort of see each one of these bins now is pretty small. But as we get more and more data, some of these bins will collapse and we'll add new ones over here. So we start losing resolution on the left side as we add more resolution on the right side. So that's kind of what this thing tries to do in a nutshell. And another nice feature of these is if you like, each one of these bins, you can keep a second, or even more if you feel like it, but in this case, a second value. So instead of just tracking, you know, the wine alcohol level, we can track something else too. I think in this case, we're also keeping track of wine quality. So it was this, is it, I think, 1 to 5 scale people ranked wine quality on, or 1 to 10. and in this case, every time we merge bins, you know, so we keep the mean of wine quality and the number of, and we already know the number of points in each bin. So every time we merge bins, we can find the new mean. So basically, we keep track of the mean of wine quality in every bin. And it means we can do nice things now of up here is one quality, and we're keeping track of that. Data is still coming in at sorted order like it did last time. But we can kind of see there's a bit of an increase that as wine alcohol goes up, people like wine more. So that's the secret to a good wine. So, and that's actually, we use the streaming histograms when building some of our trees, and that ability to keep track of another metric is actually what we use to keep track of the objective field. But if you get crazy, you can do silly things. This isn't actually in the library, this is me messing around. I put a histogram inside the histograms. So in each bin, I put another streaming histogram, which basically gives us a wacky dynamic heat map, where as data comes in, I think we're looking at how many hours worked per week and age. And data comes in, and finally the heat map kind of works itself out. Whoops. But again, at the beginning, we had no idea what the range of the data was going to be, but yet the heat map fit itself to it. So kind of a fun party trick for really boring parties. and this is just showing a little bit of, you know, actually using them. So you create one, and then you do, they're actually mutable under the hood, because it was would have been way too slow to do immutability in this case. So we do these mutable inserts, and we're just putting in a bunch of points from a normal distribution here. And afterwards, we can do things like get the sum, get the density. We can say, give me the split points that would give me uniform buckets. So here we're getting three different uniform bins. You can say, give me some percentiles, the points that give me those percentiles. We can do things like chart the sum versus the density. So this is a little like the CDF and the PDF of the distribution. And then this is just showing off details, like if we make one with 8 bins, that's what this red line is. You can see it's kind of showing this distribution, but pretty badly. But if we give it a little bit more memory to work with, 64 bins, we get much smoother curves. So we can kind of dial in how much accuracy we want with these histograms. And this is, thank you.
Just the idea, there is an algorithm that computes the median of a distribution in linear time. I don't know whether it works on streams too, but it sort of divides the data into five tuples, and then sort of iteratively is able to find the median in linear time.
Yeah, yeah.
Perhaps some...
It's probably related.
Some version of this algorithm could find quartiles.
That's what the percentile is sort of doing. So yeah, you can get an approximate median anyway, right?
Yeah,
you don't get
the
real one.
The median is exact.
In this case, you get an approximate.
Someone could find in a linear time some quantiles in an exact way, so you could...
Really, there's an exact linear time median finder?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
So just an idea that perhaps some similar approach.
No, at least
like
of what I've
finding the bins and finding the probability that the result is in the bin. One could try to find to just say, okay, I'm trying to find the boundaries so that in each bin there is fixed probability, like 1/5 of everything. So sort of inverse approach where you.
Oh, yeah. Huh, okay.
You cannot do this on streaming data. You need to have basically random access data, because you need to do multiple passes over there.
Oh, okay. So that makes sense. Yeah, because I was thinking I hadn't heard of a median finder, though. Okay. That makes sense. So this is showing off that the streaming histograms are also mergeable. So, again, if you're in this some setting where you're keeping track of metrics on multiple servers, you can send back the streaming histogram somewhere and merge them all together to get a better view. So this red, this kind of jaggy red one is showing an individual histogram. And the blue one is showing, there's 300 different merged histograms, which you can see is much smoother than the individual. So, and yeah, this is just showing off that ability to track a second field again. In this case, we're inserting, you know, we've got a normal distribution, but we're also taking the sine of each point, and we're tracking that as the kind of the payload for each bin, and then we can plot them back and see that, yep, we in fact do understand how the y-axis changes. We captured it. So, 8:30. So I do have more, but I'm getting tired. The rest is about sketching summaries, but I'm sort of thinking if you want to hear more, we could talk more about that at the bar. I think this one's going long. Yes. Okay. Well, then, thank you.